Hello, everyone everywhere. This is Pastor Robert Thibodeau. Welcome to your Freedom Through Faith video minute for today, which is March 9. We've been studying the last several days about the story of the prodigal son. We had an introduction where I just did a brief overview on day one. Then day two, we went into the study of the younger son and what he did and the sins he committed. We also studied the father on day three and everything that he was looking at and praying for. Yesterday, we did a brief overview of the other minor characters, or not minor characters, I guess you could say the other extras in this story, which was the citizen who hired the young man to go feed his pigs, and he did it out of contempt and disgust for a Jewish boy asking him for a job. We also covered briefly the town folk, the citizenry, and how that represents the Pharisees that Jesus was talking to, and they all bought in to, you know, how sinful this young boy was and how he needed to be punished and how they would support the father and scorning this boy and ridiculing him and just treating him like dirt, and how they were appalled at the father willing to run through town in disgrace, run through town to catch this boy before he hit the outskirts of town and just hug on him and kiss on him, pig stink and all, and how the father reinstated this boy to full sonship right in front of the town folk, and how appalling that would be to them. And then the father invited them to a banquet to celebrate his son's return. And because this father was such a influential citizen of that town, and I likened it to the TV show Bonanza with, you know, the Cartwrights, and how everyone respected Ben Cartwright, wanted to be in his grace and favor, and they always called him Mr. Cartwright, Mr. Cartwright. And then the boys came into town, and they'd call them by their first names, but the boys were expected to behave in a certain way and act in a certain way, and all their dealings had to be dealt faithfully and upfront because they represented a father. That's how the folks were looking at this father, and they were shocked that he would have received this boy back and with, you know, no punishment whatsoever. And now they'd been invited to the banquet, and because everyone wanted to be in the grace and favors of this father, they turned out to the banquet. I mean, when, you know, someone of influence like that invites you to come to a banquet, you go. And in that town, that's what they were doing. Now, we're going to talk today about the older son, and I probably will not get completely through this. We may have to finish it up tomorrow, but the older son, everybody thinks he's the good son. He's the son that stayed. He's the son who took over the business. He's the one who is making it prosperous, and he's the one who is dedicated to the father. But that's not what the scriptures show us. What, Brother Bob? Yes. Get your Bible in Luke chapter 15, and we'll go down to verse 25. Now, the banquet's going on. It says, now the elder son was in the field, and as he came in and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants, asked them what these things meant. And he said to them, your brother's come, and your father has killed the fatted calf because he has received him back safe and sound. And he was angry, and he would not go into the party. Therefore, his father came out and entreated him, or begged him to come inside. And he answered, he said to his father, look, these many years I have served you. I've never transgressed at any time your commandments. Yet you never even gave me a kid or a goat that I could make a party with my friends. But as soon as this, your son, has come, which has devoured your living with harlots, you've killed for him the fatted calf? And he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make a party and be glad, for this, your brother, was dead and is alive again. He was lost, but now he's been found. So here we see the older son. His attitude was, I stayed and he left. I worked and he partied. I served you and he didn't, but yet when he returns, you give him a party and you never gave me a party. Let's look at a couple of things. One, there was absolutely no relationship with his older son and his father. You can see that because of what we just read. And let me delve a little bit deeper on that. The older son is the one who in Jewish society is supposed to inherit everything. So when the father divided the inheritance, he basically took what was supposed to go to the older son and gave half of it to the younger son, who then went into town, as we studied, and sold his inheritance at pennies on the dollar just to get some cash in hand so he could leave. Number one, when the younger son said to the father, basically, I wish you were dead. Give me my inheritance. It was the older son's responsibility in Jewish culture to go to that younger boy and make him see the error of his ways one way or another. It was the older son's responsibility to stand up for the father when this younger son was ridiculing him and just, you know, treating him badly, treating the family like that. It was the older son's responsibility to take care of this situation. He did not do that. We can see from the scriptures here that the older son was the one who was running the business. And we can also see he had no relationship with the father, because the father did not even send a servant out into the field to tell him his brother was home and he was going to hold a banquet. It was the older son's responsibility, if there was a large family function like this banquet, it was his responsibility to organize it, to plan it, to let everybody know, to be the one that invited people to the banquet. And the father never had him do that. The father is the one who planned it, executed it, and invited people to it. It was the older son's responsibility in the eyes of the town folk to be that person, that contact. It was the older son's responsibility to run the business. And here we see him with no relationship with the father. More than likely, he would, you know, come in from the field in the evening, tally up the books after he paid all the day laborers and they went their way. And it would be late. He would come in. He'd probably eat by himself, maybe have a brief conversation with the father, then go and do the bookkeeping and stay up. When that was finished, he'd been exhausted. He worked all day, probably went to bed, get up early in the morning, have breakfast, and leave. If he had any interaction with the father at all, it was that moment during breakfast before he left for the day. And he would be gone all day to make sure the work got done and repeat it on the way back home that night, everything I just said. So we can see he was not spending any quote-unquote quality time with the father. And therefore, the father basically had no relationship with him at all, even though he was right there. And now that the younger son has come home and the older son feels slighted, because the younger son should have been punished. In the eyes of all the listeners that Jesus is talking to, everyone agrees this younger son needs to be punished. But he wasn't. He was receiving grace and mercy from the Father. And the banquet, and we went over this with the killing of the fatted calf, that calf was supposed to be saved for the family sacrifice. And it was, because it reunited the family together. That's the purpose of it. The father was showing the townsfolk, all is forgiven. My son has been restored. And now he had both sons home. It should be a time of partying. But it wasn't. Not in the eyes of the older son. We're going to stop this for today. Tomorrow, we're going to look at how the father was asking the older son to receive the younger son back into the family. And this will be representative. Tomorrow, we talk about this, of how the Jewish people are represented by the oldest son, and how the youngest son, the Christians, represent the sinners who left the fold and went and lived sinfully, and how the father took it upon himself to sacrifice his own reputation, so to speak, to receive them back. And now he's begging the Jewish people to ask for them to receive the sinners back into the fold because of what Jesus has done. Folks, that's all the time we have for today. We're going to finish this tomorrow. Praise God. I hope you're getting a lot out of this video series, because if you understand the symbology that Jesus was sharing, you can be blessed in all that you do with that wisdom.